Chào khán giả biết nhìn xa trông rộng, tôi là Minh Quang. Chào mừng đến với chương trình Địa cầu ngôi nhà thân ái, sinh vật biến đổi gen, mối nguy hại cho sức khỏe và môi trường, phần 2 trong 2 phần. Giới thiệu ký giả môi trường kiêm giảng viên Mark Shapiro. Ông sẽ tiếp tục chia sẻ những hiểu biết của mình về tác động lên sức khỏe và môi trường của sinh vật biến đổi gen hay GMO. Nhiều nghiên cứu khoa học đã phát hiện ra mối liên hệ giữa phương pháp sản xuất thực phẩm hiện đại và biến đổi khí hậu. Ông Shapiro thảo luận về cách thức GMO có thể làm xáo trộn hệ thống sinh thái và góp phần gây ra biến đổi khí hậu.
We have reached a point at which the impacts of climate change are already being felt. So the Earth is already undergoing what amounts to essentially environmental trauma. And that trauma is to the systems that this great, fantastic organism we have the good fortune to live on here on Earth has sustained itself and created the conditions within which we've been able to thrive. Now, this fantastic combination of gases and balancing of nutrients in the earth, in the water, gases in the atmosphere have created a unique combination of conditions to enable humans to thrive. We are now in the middle of disrupting that incredible balancing act of the earth, so we can already see the impacts of climate change all across the world in terms of the disruptive and highly volatile weather systems. And the issue now is, can we slow down the process that's already underway so that we prevent the truly catastrophic shifts that are coming our way if we keep going in the same path? Well, we already see my latest book, Seeds of Resistance, talks about the profound disturbances underway in the food-growing regions of the Earth. And those disturbances include the steadily rising temperatures, the diminishment of water supplies, the accelerating pace of extreme events that is being very disruptive to the current food system. We see it in declining yields in some of the biggest food-growing areas of the United States, for example, in the Central Valley of California. We see it in the Midwest. We see it in the Southwest. So now the question is, how do we develop a different kind of food system that is much more able to adapt to these kind of extremes? And that's what we face right now. And I do believe we can develop that. My book, Seeds of Resistance, is all about, is how to develop seeds that are capable of responding to these conditions, adapting to them, and being far more resilient to the changes that we're going through and are going to accelerate. I think there's a false dichotomy between addressing the questions around climate change and the questions around economic growth in the global economy. And the dichotomy is based on this fundamental illusion, based on this idea that here, on the one hand, we have the status quo, which is, let's say, where we are right now. And if we, as a society, begin to recognize and respond to climate change and do the kind of changes in our energy grid and our technologies and our lifestyles that are necessary, it's going to cost this much. So are we, as an economic entity, willing to spend this amount of extra money to respond to this situation? Complete illusion. Because over here, we are actually spending massive amounts of money already on the climatic disruptions that are occurring. Billions of dollars spent to deal with the kind of disasters that come through climate change, the hurricanes in this country and around the world that cost billions of dollars to recover from. So in this country, in the United States anyway, of insurance payouts to farmers whose crops fail in the face of huge crop losses due to climatic disruptions, the emergence of new diseases and illnesses that in humans and in livestock and in plants, whole new varieties of diseases and pests are costing billions of dollars to contend with, to deal with the consequence of climate change. It's just not called climate money. It's called health money over here, or it's called insurance money over there, or it's called rebuilding after a hurricane over here. All those should be called climate expenses. And once we start actually doing that, we'll see that actually investing in renewable energy and different less greenhouse gas intensive industries is not nearly as expensive as we think, and very importantly, generates huge amounts of income activity within an economy because it creates tens of thousands of new jobs, new investment opportunities. And I think you see that now in the global business sector, the major insurance companies starting to pull out of their fossil fuel investments, major financial firms starting to retreat from their investments, big companies being compelled by financial authorities in the United Kingdom, France, in Germany, elsewhere, other than the United States, of course, has retreated from this idea. But in the other major economies of the world, in Japan, companies must report to investors the threat presented by climate change to their bottom line. So in many ways, global business is even far more ahead of the political leadership. They also see enormous business opportunity in the changes ahead, the renewable energy opportunities, the numerous vast shifting of resources from fossil fuel intensive to more renewable forms of energy. What does renewable mean? On the one hand, non-renewable energy means the oil comes out of the ground and it's never coming back. We have to actually deal with this change at some point. And the longer we wait to do that change, the worse it's going to get.
Ông Mark Sabiro nhấn mạnh nhu cầu cấp bách cần hành động của nhân loại để giảm thiểu biến đổi khí hậu.
It is completely within humans' capacity to mitigate the effects of climate change. Mitigation is twofold. One is we have the capacity to reduce our contribution to climate change, and our contribution comes from the emission of greenhouse gases, which comes from the use of non-renewable fossil fuel energy sources. And we have shown over and over and over again that we completely have the capacity to do that. I live in the state of California, the biggest state in the country, arguably one of the more complex economies among all states in the United States. California has seen a steady drop in the greenhouse gas emissions over the past 5 or 6 years since there's imposed a price for carbon within the state of California through market mechanisms. So we have every capacity to both reduce our greenhouse gas emissions and we can mitigate the impact. We need to start building soft barriers along coastlines to, you know, protect people from the rising sea. I mean, we need to actually start thinking ahead about how we're going to deal with this kind of climate-stressed environment. Well, I think the decisions that you make, the actions you take, can actually have an effect on how we move forward. The decisions you make about the food you eat goes down to the seeds that are planted, which is what I describe in my book, Seeds of Resistance. And the same thing applies to the kind of energy sources that we use. You can decide to either utilize renewable energy or pressure your government to actually encourage that shift in energy sources. So this is very much within the power of humans to influence. And now is the time to be doing it.
Thưa quý khán giả thông thái, thật thân hạnh được đồng hành cùng quý vị trong chương trình Địa cầu ngôi nhà thân ái, sinh vật biến đổi gen, mối nguy hại cho sức khỏe.